while there's a major seafood crisis taking place, it's not an economic crisis, though it is. It's not an environmental crisis, though it is. It's a cultural crisis. And the cultural crisis is why brand conversations are so important. Because the nature of what has to happen is for us to claim back. This is the time to take a giant step forward into our past, into some traditions that we have to be able to hold on to. There's a quality of cultural roots from this part of the country that others further up the coast refer to as salmon nation, which is the true lifeblood of the economy on the west coast, just as truly as cod was on the east coast. So to have the salmon season shut down this year in California is the result of decades of problems not being attended to, and of cultural choices and economic choices that really overlooked critical food, energy, water issues that are all completely tied when you're dealing with the food system. In establishing a brand, we had a real advantage coming from California, coming from Northern California. First of all, it's just a major fruiting mecca. For those of you who aren't from this area, you'll appreciate this with a fresh palate and fresh eyes. For those of you who are from this part of the world, you're just spoiled rotten. This, nobody eats better than Northern California. Nobody. Sorry, LA, you're not even close. The nature of, maybe Tuscany on a good day eats as well. Southern Provence in the middle of summer comes close to the way we eat every single day. So what that does is put an enormous amount of pressure on a brand that's coming from this part of the world, because if you're not the best, and you're not as hip environmentally as you should be, and you're not paying attention to the issues at the local level, you're not going to make it in California. Not in Northern California, not in the Bay Area, not in a place that's been also the home for Odwalla juices, Nyman Ranch, and the icon of icons in the slow food movement, Alice Waters. These are small, notice these are small efforts, but they've had major national and international impact. People say, well, CleanFish, which is in the business of standing on the shoulders of other brands like Nyman Ranch, who have aggregated small counties, whole counties of the middle of the country. Their family farms are kept alive because of Nyman Ranch. And when all of the issues about farm salmon started to be talked about in January of 2004, the media and even our environmental friends, with whom I have an enormous amount of decades of background, took an approach which immediately struck me as a little bit off. And it was basically farm bad, wild good, follow the mantra, farm bad, wild good, farm bad, wild good. The problem is, if we follow that track, it became immediately clear to some of us, our kids and certainly our grandchildren would have sashimi on a good day in terms of fish, and that's all that there would be out there. The crisis of the wild fisheries is real, it's not going away. So what's essential is to redeem, redefine, and demand responsible aquaculture. And in order to do that, you have to establish a market crisis that's willing to reward those who are doing a better job and use the leverage of the marketplace to pull towards those better practices. California is a place that understands this relationship of economic movement, lifestyle movement, political movement, and dollars. I knew California was really a hit place in terms of trendsetting when I watched from my hometown. See, in my hometown of Philadelphia, it was very, very clear how trends started. They started with me and my friends on a dance floor, and then guys who were watching us on the side would go on American Bandstand. And then kids from Bandstand would be dancing, and then kids in California would start dancing those dance steps. So you had this great sense on the dance floor of having this generational responsibility to really get your steps down. When Bandstand left Philadelphia and went to California, Dick Clark was onto something that I recognized. And it was followed then by the Beach Boys and others telling us that they wished that they were all California girls, and that the Jefferson Starship telling us that we built the city on rock and roll, and all kinds of things that doesn't happen any other place in California. What's important in what got established with Odwalla and with Nyman Branch and with Alice Waters at Chez Panisse is that if you're going to deal with food and lifestyle issues, you've got to stay authentic because you're feeding people. Those of us who are really in the business of establishing lasting, values-driven brands understand that the only reason to go to the expense, the effort, the creativity, the innovation, the challenges that you go through to establish a brand is to do only one thing, and that's to establish trust. So particularly if you're in the business of feeding people, the question is, what are the conditions that make you trustworthy? And once again, the pressure of competitive, friendly environment, of working with local farmers, and working with local dairies, and working with local fishermen, all create a quality of interaction that's all tied to the energy issues and the water issues as a completely integrated whole living system. This is something that's fairly unique in its vibe to California. What's important that we learn from our colleagues who established brands before us that were all California, Northern California driven in our case. Again, Odwalla, Nyman Branch being such key players for us, is that it begins in the food category. You might want to talk about practices, and you might want to talk about environmental stewardship, and you might want to talk about husbandry of the animals, but it all has to start with taste. Because the place that gets the most connection is where people go to be really educated in the major classrooms in the foodie kingdom. And the major classrooms in the food kingdom are the restaurants. And when people go and they look up and they say, well, is this farm or is it wild? And if it's farm, where is it from? Yeah, please don't stop with is it farmed or wild. If it's farm, where is the farm from? From a brand point of view, CleanFish took a decision very early on. Any classic branding theory would have said, look, you're onto a good thing. You've got artisan producers, and you've got this good conversation. Now, you want to have everything be CleanFish. It's CleanFish salmon, CleanFish shrimp, CleanFish cod, CleanFish. And we decided very early on, no, that's not really the way we want to go. What we want is for people to understand what they're learning about other California-driven industries, mostly from high tech, about the need for backup and transparency and traceability, which we're also learning from the agricultural side. And so if we want people to understand that, we decided to build a brand that was automatic, that was immediately transparent. So it's not CleanFish salmon, it's CleanFish presents this particular river from the Rogue River salmon. CleanFish presents Tuck River salmon. CleanFish presents Loch Duart Scottish salmon. CleanFish presents groups, so that you actually got the through line of where is this from. And once again, this sense of resonance of place, this sense of congruence of practices, this orientation towards stewardship, is something that comes out of a California conversation, a cultural conversation around food that's been happening now for several decades. Artisan fisheries are small pockets of groups, and people say this is a big problem. You have to deal with the big players. But I say, you know, when I can walk into an airport because of a layover in Cincinnati or Cleveland or any one of a number of places in this country and get a organic mescaline tossed salad with balsamic dressing, before I sit down to eat, I kind of align myself to Berkeley, California, and I bow to Alice Waters. Thank you, Alice. Thank you. Because that little gnome out there in Berkeley is directly responsible for the complete storyline that became what got this salad here. Otherwise, I'd be having a winter iceberg lettuce with some bottled washing dressing at best. The point is that taste makes a difference, and California restaurants and top chefs teach us this. And we're very proud at CleanFish that the top chefs and the top restaurants have not only recognized the care of the stewardship of the CleanFish Alliance of Producers, but have been willing to put us on menu by name. And so the question of that I heard earlier, you know, that was in the initial introduction, are we in a sustainability bubble? The question is, when you look at the issues that the sustainability marketplace is speaking to, are any of these issues going away? Does anyone imagine that suddenly there's going to be a reversal and more fish are going to come back? Unless we take a significant step. And one of the things that's important for branding to understand is partnership with conservation groups and governmental groups, and understand that in the marketplace is where people can actually make a stand. We're in a political season, and people are looking at how the campaigns are going to go, anticipating what their vote's going to be. But let me suggest you vote with your fork in every meal. And you're either, and what we need to pull ourselves out of is to use the educational process of what branding, real branding is, which is educational, and bring ourselves out of the denial that we've been in, and understand there's no middle ground. You're either voting with your fork for better practices or for degrading practices, for artisan stewardship or for industrial scale practices that have never shown that they can understand the relationships between human capital, financial capital, and natural capital. It's that triple bottom line sensibility in which California brands have really taken a significant position of leadership, and we're proud to be part of it.